Yet another day before thy presence, and we pray for each and everyone present here today in the mighty name of Jesus. It is my prayer that before you depart, the Lord will have a word for you in the mighty name of Jesus. We salute our General Overseer, Dr. Emmanuel Godri, all the apostles of Christian Faith Churches, and everyone who is viewing, who will view in the mighty name of Jesus, that the Lord will touch their heart. In the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Somebody say repentance.
Repentance.
Repentance. In this month, we're talking about repentance. And today we are speaking about the way to repentance. Yes. Somebody say the way to repentance.
The way to repentance.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
From the start of creation, God created man to be, or God created man without sin. Man was created without sin. Because the Bible says in Genesis that let us make man in our own image. And we know that there is no evil in God, there is no sin in God. So man was originally created without sin. But through Adam, as the book of Romans 5:12 says, it says, therefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin. So death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Hallelujah. So the Bible says men were created without sin, but when Adam sinned, death entered the world, and death spread to all men, and therefore all men sinned. Hallelujah. The Bible again says in Romans, it says, for all have sinned and we have fallen short of the glory of God. Thanks be to God. There are people who will say, I wasn't there when Adam was sinning, so maybe the sin did not affect me. But David confirmed this in the book of Psalm 51, verse 5. He says, iniquity was I brought forth. In sin did my mother conceived me. So you were born in iniquity, and you were conceived in what? Sin. So even before your birth, or when you came into the world, as a result of the sin of Adam, you were already sinned. Hallelujah. So everybody was born with sin, but you were not created with sin. Two distinctions. Hallelujah. The book of Genesis 23 to 24, it talks something beautiful here. When Adam sinned, the Bible says God drove man out of the Garden of Eden. So when man was without sin, man was living in the garden which was created by God. So if the garden depicts the kingdom of God, or if the garden depicts what? Heaven. When man sinned, man was drove out of the Garden of Eden, according to Genesis chapter 3, 23 to 24. So if we say that if the garden were to be what? Heaven or kingdom of God, the moment man sinned, man was drove what? Out of the kingdom of God. Therefore, man was alienated from the kingdom of God. Man became an enmity, or man became an alien to the kingdom of God. So no longer can we dwell in the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. Ephesians 4:18 also says something to confirm this. Come with me as we go into the Bible. The book of Ephesians 4:18 talks about 18. I read. Having their understanding darkened, being alienated from the life of God, because of the ignorance that is in them, because of the blindness of their heart. So when sin and iniquity came into man, we became darkened in our thoughts, and we became alienated from God. Hallelujah. So therefore, we could no longer dwell with God. So therefore, we could no longer stay with God, because the scriptures confirm that there is no iniquity in God, and God cannot dwell with iniquity. Hallelujah. Psalm 5, 4 says that there is no evil in God and God cannot dwell with evil. That is why when Satan sinned in heaven, he kicked him out. When man sinned in the garden, he kicked him out. So there is no way man could come back to the kingdom of God. There is no way man could come back to God with the sins. Don't forget, the Bible even makes us believe that when Jesus was crucified, his own son Jesus, because of the sins upon him, God could not behold him. So God cannot dwell with sin. He cannot cohabit with sin. So whenever man sinned, God drives them out. So men were driven out of the kingdom of God. Glory be to God. I am happy somebody you are here to listen to the gospel today in the mighty name of Jesus. And before you go back, the Lord God will touch your heart, bringing the word and repentance to you in Jesus' mighty name. This is proof in the book of John chapter 3. Come with me. The third book of John. John chapter 3, reading from the 3. Nicodemus went to Jesus and speaking to Jesus in secrecy. Jesus answered and said to him, "Most assuredly, I say to you, unless one is born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God." So unless you become a born again, you cannot come into the kingdom of God. And remember, I told you from the book of what? Psalm 51, when David said that I was brought forth in iniquity. In sin that my mother would conceive me. So Jesus was trying to tell Nicodemus, for you to come back to the kingdom of God, which God drove Adam from, you have to be reborn before you could come. You have to be born again. And Nicodemus said, "I am too old, big. How could I go into my mother's womb for me to be born again?" So Jesus was telling Nicodemus, for you to come back, we have to readmit you. Now the only condition of the readmission is repentance. Amen. Salvation. Coming back to God. So Jesus told Nicodemus, unless you repent, unless you have salvation, you cannot come back to the Lord, to the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. I am very happy, or I am sure somebody is following, because I am building a case here. God drove men out because of sin. We were born in sin. And Jesus told Nicodemus, before you can come back to the kingdom, you have to be born again. You have to be given birth again. By what? Water and of the Spirit. In the mighty name of Jesus. So it is like men were living in heaven or in the kingdom of God. And men sinned. So God had drove us out of the kingdom and we are heading towards hell. For you to come back or for you to avoid heaven, you need to have a repentance. You need to change your mind and make a U-turn. It is like a one-way route. The end here is the Garden of Eden. The other side is the world, which is the hell. God had driven us out from kingdom of God, and we are heading towards hell. The only way we can avoid hell is to do what? A U-turn. Is to do a U-turn. So on our way to hell, we saw the notice, or we saw the signboard from Jesus in the book of Matthew 4:17. Says, "Repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand." When we saw that, we had a change of heart and we made a U-turn. So there is no way we will end up in hell because we have made what? A U-turn. So repentance simply means making a U-turn, turning away from evil and heading toward to godliness in the mighty name of Jesus. Turning away from evil sin to pursue the righteousness of God. That is repentance. And we remember in the book of Luke chapter 22. Come with me to the book Luke 22. As I do this illustration. 22:61. And this talks about Peter. Jesus said, "Before the cock will crow, pray times, Peter would deny Jesus." Peter said all that he was said. But when the time came, Peter denied Jesus. Let's read from 61. Luke 22, 61. "And the Lord turned and looked at Peter. Then Peter remembered." Somebody say, "Peter remembered."
Peter remembered.
"The word of the Lord. How he had said to him, 'Before the rooster crows, you will deny me three times.'" 62. So Peter went out and wept bitterly. He repented. He repented when he heard the word of the Lord, when he remembered the word of the Lord, when he saw that he had sinned. The Bible says he went out and he wept bitterly. His heart was rended and he wept bitterly. Repentance. Repentance. So for you to be readmitted into the kingdom of God, for you to be a born again, you need repentance. Born again depends on repentance. Without repentance, there is no forgiveness. And without forgiveness, there is no salvation. So the bit you do is your, the bit which God cannot do for you is repenting. God can grant you the grace. He can grant you the forgiveness. He will give you the salvation for free. But the only thing he will not do for you is to repent for you. So repentance depends upon you. God will not repent for you. No matter where you, somebody has committed their crime and you've repented for them, you can't. It's like when somebody is sick and you want to take medication for them. It doesn't work. Or somebody is hungry and you want to eat for them. It doesn't work. Likewise, repentance is an individual thing. It is a customized thing. Everybody ought to repent of their own. A mother cannot repent for their children. Children cannot repent for their parents. You can pray for them, but you cannot repent for them. Hallelujah. Repentance, repentance, repentance. And before one could repent, as I said, this is a seminar for us to check our life. One key thing we will look at for repentance is what? Humility. Without this, you can never and ever repent. Without humility, one can never repent. And when we say to humility, to be humble or able to humble, ability to come down in the name of Jesus. Let's read the book of 2 Chronicles 7:14. It is very common and we love quoting this. It says, if my people who are called by my name will humble and pray, and I, God, will hear them. Hallelujah. It is a key thing. If my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I. So until then, without the humility, you are wasting your time. Then will I. So this is a condition. We spoke of the promises of God. This is one of the promises of God with condition. So until you are humble, God will not hear you. And until you humble, unless with humility, you cannot repent. Hallelujah. I will prove you further as we go down. Let me read another translation. If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will. So you see the condition there. God did not say that then I will hear them. Then I will. So you must do something in order for God to do something. One ought to what? Humble in order for him to have what? Repentance. Without humility, there is no repentance. James 4 says something. James 4, 6. Come with me. James 4, 6. The book of James, chapter 4, verse 6. I'm talking about humility for repentance. James 4, 6. But he gives more grace. Therefore, he says, God resists the proud, but give grace to the what? To the humble. Do we need this grace in salvation? Watch the word there, grace. And the Bible says, God give grace to the humble. So if you are humble, you could repent. If you are humble, God will give you grace. So, for instance, Sister B is humble. God has given him grace. Let's see what he will use the grace for. Come with me to Ephesians 2, verse 8. The book of Ephesians 2, 8. Ephesians 2, 8. And I read, for by what?
Grace.
Where did you get this grace from? From your humility. He says, for by grace you have been saved. So grace is like a ticket. You've ordered something from Argos. You have your code or ticket. You go to Argos with that. You can redeem your item. So when you are humble and you repent, God gives you the grace, which is the code for what? Salvation. So without humility, you will not have the grace. Are you following?
Yes.
Have I confused anybody yet? Without humility, one cannot have what? The grace. And without the grace, you cannot have what? Salvation. So humility is important in the life of a believer. For you to repent, you need humility. In everything you do, in meekness, in everything you do, in humility, exalting one another, don't see yourself as all-knowing or all-knowing. We need to be humble in our walk. Jesus Christ has been depicted as a lamb because of his humility. He humbled himself unto death, even death upon what? Upon the cross. Some of us, we are too proud. And the one that kills or annoys me most is the empty pride. There are people, they have nothing. They are no one. They are not doing anything significant, but yet they are proud. I don't know what makes them proud. But as a child of God, you cannot be proud. Because you have demonstrated your humility. Therefore, you became a child of God. You cannot come into the kingdom and behave otherwise. You cannot come into the kingdom and behave otherwise. So every child of God is humble. All righteous people are humble. Can we conclude that way? I could see laughter. So if you are not humble, then you ought to check your life. Because one of the main characteristics of a believer is what? Humility. Humility. We're talking of repentance. And what got us repentance is what? Humility. And as a result of that, we got salvation. So you cannot say, okay, I was Alexaki and I applied to the home office. They gave me papers and I'm now Daniel something else. It's impossible. Wherever you go, they will say, no, it is not you. You are impersonating somebody. If you don't take care, they will arrest you. The same way you cannot say you are humble and you are given salvation and you are beginning to act or live otherwise. Then people will know, no, this is not a true child of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
The way of repentance. The way of repentance. Today we're talking about the way of repentance, but we wanted to see how we got to repentance in the first place. And before we go into further, come with me to the book of Luke 24:47. The way of repentance. How to repent? How do we get to repentance? Luke 24:47. It says something there. I read, and that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name to all nations. Jesus Christ from the 46 says, then he said to them, thus it is written, and that it was necessary for Christ to suffer and to rise from what? From dead on the third day. And that repentance, what? Remission of sins should be preached to all people. And I said that repentance begets forgiveness. And Jesus said in the book of Luke 17:4, he says, if your friend sins, no matter times, and he comes and says, I have repented, you must forgive him. So repentance begets forgiveness. So Jesus is talking about repentance and remission of what? Of sins. Hallelujah. So before one will be forgiven, the person will have to what? Repent. The person will have to repent. And I'm taking you through the way of repentance. The first one is encounter. Somebody say encounter.
Encounter.
And when we say encounter, in the book of Acts chapter 9, when we read from 1 to 5, we know that there was a man by name Saul. The Bible says Saul sought permission from the high priest to go to Damascus and destroy those who are doing the works of what? Of God. He sought permission from the high priest, which is baffling, isn't it? You will think he will seek permission from the Buddhists, from the Hindus, but then he sought permission from the high priest who did not believe in Jesus Christ. So Paul was on his way to destroy those who are following Jesus and doing the things of Jesus Christ. As I speak, there are people who the enemy has consulted in order to destroy you. The word of God says, whenever they gather together, surely they will fall for thy sake. And I speak to you this afternoon. Whenever they gather together against thee, they shall fall. Whoever is seeking permission to destroy you shall be encountered by God. Anybody who has permission to destroy you will be battled by the Holy Spirit. Let the angels of God arise and defend you. In the mighty name of Jesus. When Satan wanted to touch Job, he sought permission from God. So until the permission is granted, the enemies or your foes will not do you anything. Anybody with injunction over your life, we come against them in the mighty name of Jesus. Anybody who has permission over your marriage, we break it by the blood of Jesus. We void their legal grounds in the mighty name of Jesus. Then Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked letters from him to the synagogues of Damascus, so that if he found any who were of the way, who were of the way? What way is he talking of? The way of Christ. Don't forget, Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. So Paul, with understanding, was pursuing those who were following Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Whether man or woman, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. As he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly a light shone around from heaven. Somebody says, suddenly a light shone around from heaven. Any demonic activities around you, may the light of God shine upon them. Any demonic activities around your finances, may the light of God shine around them. Any demonic activities around your career, let the light of God shine it upon them. In the mighty name of Jesus. The Bible says darkness cannot comprehend what? Lightness. Let the light of God arise over your life. Let the light of God arise over your family. Let the light of God be a lamp unto your feet. And may he shine forth your way in the mighty name of Jesus. May he brighten your way. May he brighten your path. May he guide your feet. Let this light of Yahweh be upon you in the mighty name of Jesus. The light shineth. When there is light, it meant to bring illumination. So you shouldn't stumble, but this light caused Paul to stumble. So when the light of God shineth upon you, your enemies will stumble. They do the opposite. Because when there is darkness, you meant to what? Stumble. But when light comes, you meant to see clearly. But when the light of God shineth, your foes will do the opposite. Oh, may they be convicted by their own mistakes. In the mighty name of Jesus, let your foes commit their own mistake. In the mighty name of Jesus. There was a time a man desired to kill Mordecai, and he was hanged by his own gallows. Anybody who has planned and intentions to destroy you, may the light of God, let the light of God shine upon them in the mighty name of Jesus. So encounter. Before you could repent, one would have to have encounter with God or the Word. We know from John 1, it says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God. So you have to have encounter with the Word. Paul saw what? The Word. He saw Jesus himself. Come with me to verse 5. Acts 9, verse 5. This is Paul speaking. And he said, who are you, Lord? Then the Lord said, I am Jesus. Paul, you knew the person and you asked him. He said, who are you, Lord? You should simply say, who are you? Because Paul was a man of authority. But he encountered something unique, which he couldn't fathom. So he had no option than to address Lord. He saw that there was something powerful. And this light will shine upon you, making every darkened aspect of your life brighten in the mighty name of Jesus. Any part of your life which is not yielding, may this light bring illumination in the mighty name of Jesus. Paul had an encounter. And I said, before you could repent, you have to have an encounter with the Word or Jesus himself. The moment Peter saw Jesus in the book Luke 22, 61, the Bible says when he looked at Jesus, he remembered, he encountered. Come with me to the book of Ephesians 1, 3. Ephesians 1, chapter 3. Ephesians 1, 13. In him you also trusted, after you heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, in whom also, having believed, you were sealed with the Holy Spirit. So one ought to encounter. You cannot repent without the word. You need to hear the word. Hallelujah. So first is what? Encounter. And this encounter is of God. Come with me, you will see something in the book of John. John 6:44. The book of John 6:44. Talking of encountering, you need to encounter God. That is the first aspect. Encounter the word. First aspect of your repentance. John 6:44. I read. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him. And I will raise him up at the last one, the last day. He says, no one can come to me except my Father who draws him. That is why we have the predestination, foreknowledge, and everything. So anyone who comes of Christ, unless God had drawn that person. And how do God draw men? With the word. Having an encounter. Nicodemus had an encounter. Paul had an encounter. Peter had an encounter. And therefore, they had a change of heart. To start with, it's encounter. Somebody say encounter. Read Acts 11:18. The book of Acts 11:18. I want you to know that encounter. So for you to be convinced of your deeds as a believer, you need the word every day. David said, your word have I hidden in my heart, such that I will not what? Sin. So you need a word, you need an encounter in order to prove or reprove your actions. Acts 11:18. When they heard these things, they became silent and they glorified God, saying, then God has also granted to the Gentiles repentance to life. So they knew that the repentance was coming from God. Hallelujah. So first is what? Encounter. The second is acknowledgement. When we say to acknowledge, to accept the existence of something. I have sent you an email. Could you acknowledge receipt? And you will send me back, yes, I've seen the email. You've acknowledged that it exists. So for you to repent, you need to acknowledge your sins. You need to admit. You need to believe that you are a sinner. So acknowledgement. If you don't acknowledge or believe you are sick, you will never go to the GPs. Who here has gone to the doctors and says, I'm okay, I'm just coming to see you? That is also a sign of psychosis. You live in denial. Hallelujah. So one ought to what? Acknowledge. Say to somebody, acknowledge. There are people who never acknowledge they or admit they've done wrong. They always believe they are what? Perfect. And those people, don't look at her. Those people are associated or connected with the word pride. Because they can't be humble to repent. So with their pride, they always admit or believe they are right. They will never believe they are right. Today the Lord is speaking to somebody. I've taken my time. I want you to have a full understanding. Hallelujah. Amen. The way to repentance. The way to repentance. And I said the first one is encounter. Second is acknowledgement. And I am reading from the book of Psalm 51, verse 3. David was saying something. This is when David had what? Confronted by the prophet Nathan. He encountered. Thereafter, look at what he did. For I acknowledge my transgression, and my sin is always before me. So when you acknowledge, it becomes what? An evidence for conviction. You acknowledge. You believe. David said, my sins are before me. When Nathan finished speaking to him, quickly he was giving judgment. And when he said, the man is you, he said, I acknowledge my sins. David was a humble man. That's why God says, a man after my heart. Meaning when the heart of God is not there, it is David who is there. So David can sustain God to bring. Because if you say, okay, my son is after me, meaning in your absence, your son is there. So if you say, David, a man after my heart, meaning he's after your heart. A man for your heart. A man in his heart. God loved David so much because of what? His attitude.
Yeah.
Amen.
Now some of us, we call ourselves our believers. My God. Even when our sisters see us coming, they want to sit well. People run away from you. But God says, a man after my heart. My own heart. May this be your cry. May this be your prayer. In the mighty name of Jesus. Come with me to Psalm 32, 5. Psalm 32, verse 5. This is the same man speaking. I acknowledge my sin to you, and my iniquity I have not hidden. I said I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgive the iniquity of my sin. You cannot hide your sin. I don't know if you ever gone to the bathhouse before. The way you stand, that is how God sees you. Miller is thinking about it. You can't hide anything. There is no blind spot. There is no blind spot. You can't hide anything before God. David said, if even I make my bed in the deepest depth, there you will be. He's all-knowing God. You can't hide anything. That's why David says, search my heart and know if there is any iniquity before me. Beloved, you can't hide it. He did say something in the book of Psalm 66, 18. He said, if I harbor iniquity, if I hide them in my heart, the Lord God will not hear me. Acknowledge, acknowledge. The next point is conviction. So once you acknowledge, there is a fact there. And anybody or a person will only be convicted based on the evidence. If you go to the law court, based on the evidence, they will convict you. And when you acknowledge, the sins are before there. So the Holy Spirit convicts you in your heart. The Holy Spirit convicts you in your heart. The Holy Spirit, that's what? Convicts you in your heart. Let's go back to Psalm 51. David said a lot there. Psalm 51, read verse 4 for me. Against you, you only have I sinned. Because the evidence was there clearly. And done this evil in your sight, that you may be found just when you speak, and blameless when you judge. So this is the conviction. David sinned against the man, but the sin wasn't for the man, it was against God. Are you catching the revelation? Joseph confirmed this. He says, God forbid, I will not do this abomination against my God. And it wasn't God who was standing there. It was a beautiful, pretty lady. But Joseph said, I will not do this against what? My God. So the sins we commit against men are against God. Because the principles of God doesn't permit you as a believer to act the way you acted. So you have disobeyed the word. And Samuel said to Saul, obedience is sacrifice. It's better than what?
Sacrifice.
So for you to disobey what the Bible says and do that evil to your sister, you have sinned against God and humanity. It's a double sin. The noble sin. Repentance. Convictions. Being convinced of the truth. So when you acknowledge your sins, you realize that you are a sinful sinner. So you see the truth and you get convinced by those truths. Hey, my sins are heavy. They are too dreadful. These sins are leading me to hell. These sins will lead me to destruction. Based on that, you get convinced and you get convicted by the word. Then sorrow sets in. The next step, sorrowful. That is found in 2 Corinthians 7:10. It says, godly sorrow leads to what? Repentance. Godly sorrow leads to what? Repentance. Worldly sorrow will not lead to repentance. And I told you of the difference between worldly sorrow and godly sorrow. Judas had a worldly sorrow, and Peter had a godly one, sorrow. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Godly sorrow. He says, for godly sorrow produces repentance leading to salvation. Not to be regretted, but the sorrow of the world produces death. No wonder Judas what? Died. So when you read the Bible and you compare with scripture, you begin to understand certain things. People say they read the Bible, they don't understand, they don't take their time for the Holy Spirit to minister to them. So why did Judas die and Peter lived? Because Judas had a worldly one, sorrow. Peter had a godly sorrow that prompted him and he lived. So you see the difference. Glory be to God.
Amen.
We thank God for his grace. And when you feel sorrow, you confess. Abundance of the heart, the mouth will speak. Abundance of the heart, the mouth will speak. So when you feel that sorrowful, you know that you have wronged, you begin to confess. The Bible says in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our iniquity. James 5:6 says, confess your sins one to another. Confession. There are people who never confess. They will presume, oh, you've done this. But instead of them to be humble enough and come back and say, on the earth, I thought of this, but I realize it's not you, I'm sorry. They will never do it. But James 5 says, confess your sins to one another and pray. Confession. Somebody say confession. The way of repentance. You ought to confess. You have to acknowledge. You have to be convicted. You need to be sorrowful about it. Godly sorrow. And you need to confess your sins. Confess your iniquities. Let's read the book of 1 Samuel 7:6. The book of 1 Samuel 7:6. The book of 1 Samuel 7:6. It says something like this. So they gathered together at Mizpah, and drew water and poured it out before the Lord. And they fasted that day and said, then we have sinned against the Lord. And Samuel judged the children of Israel at Mizpah. They came, they poured water, fasted, and they confessed that we have sinned against God. That is why the Bible says we need to search our hearts. We need to confess our sin daily. Hallelujah. And ask forgiveness. The moment you confess your sins, forgiveness follows. You need to ask for forgiveness. Because repentance, the essence of repentance is for forgiveness. So you ask for forgiveness. The book of Matthew 6:12 says, forgive us our trespasses. When Jesus was teaching them how to pray, he did not leave this bit out. Forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. But most of us, we want the A part, forgive us our trespass. We don't want the second part, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Some believers are unforgiving. They will not forgive you. Hey, one thing the sister did 5 years, you still hold her accountable to it. Hebrews 8 says something that I, God, will forgive you your iniquities and I will remember them what? No more. I will forgive you what? Your iniquities and I will remember them what? No more. But some of us, hey, we don't forgive. Oh. I am reading the book of Hebrews chapter 8, verse 12. For I will be merciful to their unrighteousness and their sins and their lawless deeds. I will remember no more. Some will say, oh, I've forgiven you, but I can't forget. But God said he will not remember anymore. Christianity or believing in God, we need to follow the principle. We shouldn't be choosing people. Choose and pick. It's like we've gone for a buffet. We are choosing the things that suit us. That is what most believers do. If the scripture doesn't suit them, they don't take it. They don't read it. A lady was baffled when I read to her that submit to your own husband. What? This is the Bible. No, she will not agree with me. No, I didn't know this in the Bible. But she knew that husbands love your wives. I once prayed to my dad, I said, parent, provoke not your children. I'm too rough. But every parent knows, children, obey your parent, for that is what? Right in the Lord. We don't have to be choosing people. Let us read the whole sentence. Don't be like some sister I know at the back there. Hallelujah. Don't choose and pick. So we ought to forgive people when they offend us. There are things that bothers us a lot. We harbor things, bitterness, pain, everything. That is why our generation are dying young, because stress is causing a lot of damage. Whenever you are bitter, you release stress hormones because of the anger. So imagine if you are embittered twice a day. That is why our generation are being sick. We don't do anything. Before, we used to go out to play. These days, we don't. We are sitting behind our computers and always stressed. So we are doing double harm to ourselves. Be forgiving. Be forgiving. Be forgiving. Be forgiving. Jesus, even at the point of death, somebody who was nailed, he was in pain, yet he was still forgiving somebody. The nails were very heavy nails. He was suffering for the same cause, but yet he was forgiven. Stephen, when he was stoned at the point of death, he says, Father, forgive them. But these days, this modern day believers, don't go near them all. If even you preach and you don't say the words right, you are in trouble. They will leave church. They will not talk to you. They will not call you because you've said something that hurts them. Paul said, make room for friends. Beloved, we need to go all out. We need to have a heart of gold, that of God. We need to get to that point that certain things doesn't bother us. We harbor iniquity too much. Bitterness, unforgiveness is iniquity, according to the word of God. Because it says, he who knew or he who knows what is good and he does not do them, the same is what? Sin. So if you know that bitterness is what? Unforgiving is sin, and you don't, you are sinning. Whoever knows good and doesn't do them, the same is what? Sinning. So today, if you didn't know yesterday, today I have told you that if you don't forgive your brother, your sister, you are sinning. And therefore, iniquity is in your heart. And we learned last week that sin can do what God cannot do. Don't belittle that little sin. Hebrews 12 says, little sin that begets, easily begets you. You don't see them as sin. So they are small, but they easily what? Begets you. They easily cause you to fall. They easily cause you what? To fall. We need to be very careful. I am reading Hebrews 12, verse 1. Therefore, we also, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which is so easily ensnares us. And let us run with endurance the race that is set before us. All those bitterness are heavy. It's like when you are walking and you are pulling those trolley, you cannot walk the way you would want to walk. But some of us, we are pulling two trolleys. We put one on top of it, the other on top of it, so we cannot even walk at all. We need to let go. Tell your neighbor, we need to let go. You cannot be a repentant soul with what? Bitterness in your heart. With unforgiving heart. Who are you at all that you don't want to forgive somebody? This one thing that the brother did, I will not forgive him. This one thing that the wife did, the husband did, I will not forgive her anymore. We need to be what? Forgiven. If you have been practicing all these things, there will be peace in our homes. In the mighty name of Jesus. The seventh point on the way of repentance is what? Turning away from evil. Somebody say, turning away from evil. Turning away from evil. Remember in the book of Luke 15:18, when the prodigal son realized that he was in a wrong place, he said, I will go. Meaning he turned away. He stopped to be where he was. He left where he was. So when you pray or when you have conviction and you have acknowledgement, the next thing you do is you need to turn away. It is like you are on the way to Birmingham. And you realize you have forgotten your passport because you're going to Birmingham Airport. The only way you can get to your passport is to make a U-turn. If you continue to go, you will never get to the... You could get to the airport, but you never what, get onto the flight. So for you now, as you hear the word of God, for you to make amendments, you ought to make a U-turn. Turn away and walk the opposite way. That is why the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, when you come to Christ, you are a new creation. All old things are passed away. That is to say, the attitude of the world, the things of the world, the behavior of the world are no longer your desire. You don't have the taste anymore. If you used to drink and you come to Christ, the taste but what diminishes, the way you dress in the world, you cannot dress the same as in the world. The way you talk, because humility will clothe you. So your things will change. That is turning away. And that is the result of what? Repentance. Repentance, the result of repentance. People will see that this person is a new person. The way of repentance. And the way of repentance results in a change attitude. Turning away from iniquity. That is why Jesus, whenever he encountered people, he says, go and sin no more. Because he believes that once we've repented, the attitude for sin will not be there. The desire to sin will not be there. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. Amen. I know some of you are wondering that, hey, but I've been sinning here and there, and the Bible says we should confess our sins. So what kind of sins is the Bible talking of? The greatest of all sin is unbelieving. The greatest sin is unbelieving. Not believing in Christ. That is the greatest of all sin. The abomination of all the sins. I do not believe in God. Then you have judged yourself. You are not even on this side for you to be considered. So when we come to Christ also, we realize that there are little sins, and I'm going to take you through them. Not encouraging you, but I will show you why. Because now it looks like people are a bit confused. You say we should turn away and do this, but then I am confronted by iniquity. I am confronted by sin every now and then. Come with me to the book of, let's read from Romans 7:19. To bring understanding to this quickly, and we'll be finishing. Romans 7:19. Paul said something. He says, "For the good that I want to do, I do not do, but the evil I will not do, that I practice." If you go further, he says, "Now I do that because of the sin that liveth in me." Beloved, if you become a born again believer, and you realize that sin, or when you sin, before then, let me take you to this and bring you down for full understanding. Let's go to John 16, when we're talking of the Holy Spirit convicting the world and the righteous. The Holy Spirit does not convict the believers of sin. The Holy Spirit does not convict the believers of sin. The Holy Spirit convicts the believers of what? Righteousness. Are you confused? Let's read the scripture. John 16. John 16. John 16. I am reading from 8 and 9. "And when he has come, he will convict the world of sin." We are not of the world. We are in this world, not of the world. Are you catching it? Oh, so hold it there. Jesus said that we are in this world, but not of the world. We are ambassadors of Christ, so we have come from somewhere to sojourn on this earth. But the Holy Spirit is coming to convict the world. So the world is the unbelievers. The world is what? It's the unbelievers. The moment you accept Christ, you leave the world into the world, which is the kingdom of God. So when the Holy Spirit is convicting the world, you are not part of it. Let's go further. 8. I'm reading again. "When he has come, he will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment." Amen.
Amen.
"Of sin, because they do not believe in me." So those unbelievers, the Holy Spirit convicts them. Then they believe. When Paul was an unbeliever, the Holy Spirit convicted him and he believed. Mm-hmm. Mary Magdalene, the Holy Spirit convicted him and he believed. Mm-hmm. Peter, when he sinned, the Holy Spirit convicted him of righteousness. I'm coming there. Of sin, because they do not believe me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and they see me no more. Who was Jesus talking to?
Christians.
He was telling them that he's going to his Father and they will see them. They see him what? No more. But the Holy Spirit is coming. And when the Holy Spirit comes, he will convince the world. And he will convince them of righteousness. When we talk of righteousness conviction, I once had a gift from a friend. And it was a very good suit from George. You know George? Oh, and in fact, I didn't want to offend this man, friend, so I wore the suit and I went to a place and it's like the whole world was looking at me. I sat there, nobody knew, but I knew the label of the suit. And I know where I get my suit. And I was troubled. I did not hear anything. Before the end of the fashion, I already ran and changed it. So you, as a believer, when you sin, the Holy Spirit convicts you that you are not this. This is not you. Are you catching it? That's why you begin to feel trouble in your spirit. You can't sleep. You can't do this. And you begin to weep. Because it convicts you, tells you, no, this is not you. You are better than this. The Holy Spirit will point you to all the good things and says, this is you. This one is not you. So the Holy Spirit is not convicting you of the sinner. The same God will take care of you, but he's convicting you that you are better than this. That is what happened to the prodigal son. When he was there, if we liken it to the kingdom of God, he began to say that even those in my father's house, he didn't say that, why am I eating this? But he said, those in my father's house. So the righteousness was compared to. So you as a believer, when you sin, the Holy Spirit compare you to your righteousness. And you begin to know that you are falling short. Therefore, the Bible says, for all have sinned and has fallen short of the glory of God. You realize that it is what? Lower standard. Let me say something. Sheila would not like me to say. Let me say this quickly. When we went to Ghana, she had a rash. And suddenly she was feeling uncomfortable. Everybody is looking at me. I said, nobody is looking at you. She was very uncomfortable and crying, oh, this is rash. Everybody is looking at me. This. I said, nobody even noticed. They wouldn't even know. But she wasn't happy because she knew herself that this is not her skin. So she wasn't right. The same way when you sin as a righteous person, the Holy Spirit convicts you and you begin to see that, no, this is not you. You are better than this. So the Holy Spirit convicts you of righteousness. Are you with me?
Yeah.
And therefore you would want to take your rightful position. As I said, I went quickly to change to my normal suit. I would want to. The same way you would want to quickly come back to the kingdom of God. And anybody who sins freely is not a born again person. If you are here and you sin and you don't feel anything, you go home, you're too excited, you are not a born again person. Because when you accept Christ, the Holy Spirit comes and dwells in you. Galatians 5, what does it say? 17. Come with me, Galatians 5, 17. The book of Galatians 5, 17. He says something there. He says, for the flesh lusts against the spirit, and the spirit against the flesh. And these are contrary to one another, so that you do not do the things that you wish. So when you receive Jesus Christ for salvation, the Spirit of God is dwelling in you. So the Spirit is in you and your flesh. So when your flesh desires to sin, then the Spirit what wages war. That's why it says in the system, walk in the spirit so that you don't fulfill the lust of the flesh. So if you feed the flesh too much without praying, then the flesh becomes bigger than the spirit. But even so, when you sin, you realize that the spirit will be waging war against what? The flesh. But if you sin and there's no contention, meaning there's no spirit in you. Have you got that bit well? So you, as a child of God, you will have the edge to sin. There will be opportunities to sin. Then the spirit will overcome the flesh. Joseph had a clear opportunity to sin. But the Lord, David was confronted with the opportunity to sin. And the flesh overcame his spirit and he fell. So there will be contention. But when we sin, the Holy Spirit convicts us of our righteousness. Then we go to God in confession and God forgives us. When the unbeliever sins, the Holy Spirit convicts them of their what? Of their sin, and they go to God in confession. They will also have what? Repentance, or they will have salvation. And Jesus says something in the book of Matthew 26:41. He says that the flesh The spirit is willing, but the flesh is what? Weak. But we need to pray. The only way to overcome the flesh is prayer. Matthew 26:41. The only way to overcome the flesh is what? Is prayer. So we need to know that we need to pray at all times. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Quickly, let's go to Matthew 26:41. It says, watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is what? Weak. So we need to pray. Rosalina said, when I stop praying, I become flesh. So I don't eat, I pray to heighten the spirit. So every believer, you have the spirit of God in you, and whenever sin is coming in, you feel that contention. There are times that you feel very guilty. I have dropped a paper on the way. I've walked for about 10 minutes. I have been convicted. I had to go back and pick it. Conviction. The Holy Spirit will convict you of righteousness. So you as a child of God, the scripture says in 1 John 2, it says, dear little children, I tell you this. My little children, these things I write to you so that you may not sin. And if anyone sins, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. And he himself is the propitiation for our sins, and not for us only, but also for the whole world.
Amen.
So we have an advocate. So John desired that we do not sin. But it says if we sin, we have an advocate. So we have to let Jesus what intercede for us. So you as a child of God, every day you have to check your life. Known and unknown what sins. Sometimes when you feel that you will be struggling with sin. You struggle with the sin. Do I do this or not to do this? When you diverge into prayer, it will turn situations around. In the mighty name of Jesus. David repented when Nathan came to him. Paul repented when he encountered God. The jailer in the book of Acts 16. Let's read the book of Acts 16, verse 30. The book of Acts 16, verse 30. It says something there. This is when Paul and Silas. So the jailer said, and he brought them out and said, sex. He called them sex because of the encounter. Paul said, what? Lord. And whenever the presence of God manifests, it humbles you. Remember, I said, without humility, you cannot repent. So the jailer, who is meant to be the boss, Paul was in his jail, but he's now calling them sirs. Humility. What must I do to be saved? What must I do to be saved? He had repented. He has been convicted. He has acknowledged that he's a sinner. And he has been convicted by his own evidence. He has felt sorrow. So he was asking Paul, what do I do in order to be saved? I want this question to go to yourself. What do you do in order to maintain your salvation? Mary Magdalene, with her alabaster box, when she repented, that which was expensive to her was no longer expensive or useful to her. She broke the box. Her hair. Woman, you can't even touch their Brazilian hair. But this was the hair, natural hair. She used the natural hair to wipe the feet of Jesus. Humility. Humility. If I ask somebody to wipe even your handkerchief or their face towel, hey, you'll be in trouble. If you even touch it, you'll be in trouble. Let alone the wiping with the hair. It shows you the level of what? Humility. Don't forget she had alabaster eye, meaning she was top. She wasn't low somebody. She was a top woman. For her to afford that, she broke it. Paul said, I count it all done, save the knowing of the Lord. Everything he had before coming to God was useless to him because of the humility that he encountered. Because of the humility. My last scripture is taken from Acts 17:30. It says, truly, these times of ignorance God overlooked, but now commands all men everywhere to repent. To repent. We need to repent daily. It's a daily something we have to do. We are now in Christ, so we need to repent of our sins for our righteousness whenever we are convicted of it. We need to check our life. We are striving for perfection, or we are following the Lord. There are times that you make certain decisions you will not even know, but ignorantly and sincerely, you could err. You could err. May the Lord God bless you.
Amen.
May the countenance of the Lord be your portion. Amen. May God aid you in all that you do.
Amen.
In the mighty name of Jesus. And any unrepented sin in your life, may the Lord God forgive you. Let's put our hands together for Jesus. In the mighty name of Jesus. Let's do it together for Jesus.